I lectured on last time was this bounded. This is work of so the situation is if we have we are trying to solve the Ricci-Plug equation, so Einstein equations in vacuum, and you start off with an initial data set. Data set such that the curvature, so the Riemann curvature that G belongs to 2 of sigma, so this is local, so it's a local norm, and the first derivative of the second fundamental form, okay, also belongs to 2. And in addition, you need another assumption about sigma, which is a lower level assumption, like something like the radius of injectivity of sigma is bounded by sigma. Right? In other words, you can cover sigma by a finite number, basically. So this is also asymptotically flat. And you can cover sigma by a finite number of coordinate charge. So another assumption which is always needed, because otherwise we don't even have some place for it. And also, this kind of assumption is relatively easy to transport it when you prove the development result. Anyway, so this is what it is. And then the result is that there exists a mean. So actually, I should say, I'm cheating a little bit here. In fact, the initial data is supposed to be smooth. So let's say C infinity of sigma. But the bounds that I'm interested in will depend only on this. In other words, there exists a unique solution in an interval 0 t. So let's say this star maximum domain. So I should say if there exists a unique development in the following sense, this is sigma, let's say sigma zero, and you construct the spacetime to get those foliations sigma t, so there exists to get those foliations. Given by a time function, so sigma d is t equal constant. So this is a time function such that the level surfaces are maximum. So this is a maximum rotation. By the way, the initial data also is assumed to be maximum. So trace k is equal to 0. And it stays that way. So the trace k is equal to 0 in the development. And the time, so the important thing here is that this time of existence, the maximum time of existence, depends only on these things. It depends only on this. So the initial data can be taken as being smooth, that's not important. The important thing is that you can extend the space-time as long as this quantity is remained bound. That's sort of the main point. Okay. Now, first, I explain the result and why it's important, and motivation, and also the fact that this seems to be open. It doesn't seem to be, at least, there doesn't seem to be any chance at this point to improve the regularity again. Which is a problem because you'd like to. In a certain sense, we'd like to do even better. There is, as far as the scaling of the Einstein equations are concerned, there is a half derivative. You think that you can get half a derivative. But unfortunately, you cannot, and you cannot because of the Eichmann equation. So there is another scaling which has to do with the Eichmann equation. That means that G alpha. So in order to prove such a result, you need to construct, like very often, we need to construct some null planes, as you shall see. And to construct null planes, you have to solve the Eichmann equation. And there is a scaling associated with the Eichmann equation, which is different from the usual scaling. And because of this, this result which seems to be open. Okay, so anyway, so this is what we discussed. And then the strategy of the proof, first of all, as we discussed last time, you cannot use coordinates in this business. The coordinates will be very badly behaved. So if you, for example, if you use the coordinates of Yvon Chauquet-Bouvard, which you have had so-called wave gauge or harmonic gauge, this will not work because at the heart of a proof of this is the so-called null condition. Null condition, which you don't have in standard coordinates. So this is what I started to do last time. Prove the bounded to curvature conjecture. So this was a conjecture according to which you can solve the initial value problem for the epsilon equations relative to a maximum foliation. So you construct a space-time convergence of foliation, which is maximum. So this is sigma d. And you typically get the, of course, you always get the local existence result. But the standard things require that T star depend on a lot more derivatives on the metric. Okay? So what I want is to get an optimal result insofar as conditions on the metrics are concerned. So the classical result of emotional Hebrouard require HS of G and HS minus 1 of second fundamental form. And this has to be quite large, has to be larger than pi half. So here you are at the level of just two derivatives. And of course, it's also important here that all these things are non-geometric. So everything is non-geometric. So the idea is that you have an initial data set which is maximum, so trace k is equal to zero. You also make an assumption on the radius of injectivity of this boundary. So you have a finite number of coordinate patches. And as I explained, this is something easy to control with time. So the result is that, well, so the conjecture and now the result is that this maximum time of existence of such a space-time to deal with this maximum foliation depends only on these two things. And of course, radius of injectivity plus radius of injectivity. In fact, volume radius, lower volume.
I'm just trying to read what grad k is.
Oh, so this is L first derivative
L2.
Okay. L2 log. So it's only a local. It's a local equation. And so this is a first derivative. So this is a curvature of the metric, and this is a first derivative of the second fundamental form. Okay. So this is at the level of two derivatives of the metric. This one derivative.
Could you do a local derivative on curvature?
Yeah. This is also local. Okay. So that's what it is. And as I explained last time, this result seems to be optimal, even though from the point of view of scaling, it looks like you could do better. You could hope that you might go all the way to 3.5 from the point of view of scaling. But in reality, there is another more subtle scaling that has to do with the Eichmann equation. And so this the equation in U, so U, the level surfaces of U are null planes. So you want to construct a family of null planes. In order to prove such a result, you have to construct a family of null planes. Otherwise, you can't do it. And to construct this family of null planes, you have to solve the Eilenberg equation. And there is another scaling at the level of this equation, for which s equal to 2 is optimal. You can definitely not go to in particular, you need a radius of injectivity of these null planes bounded below from 0. A lower bound, in other words. You need a lower bound, and you can only do it if s is equal to 2. Anything less than 2 completely breaks down. So the geometry of null hypersentences will break down. And as a consequence, everything else you want to do will collapse. And as I explained last time, the key to prove such a result is the null condition. So you need the nonlinear structure of the equation to play a fundamental role. And if you try to do, if you try to use harmonic coordinates, right, like the ones you also are using for the heat flow, then you will not see this null condition. So you'll never be able to prove such a result in coordinates. So I mean, we don't, in fact, we try very hard. In coordinates, it looks hopeless. You just get completely lost. So instead, we use frames. And in this frame condition, you use Cartan formulation. You get a Young-Mills formulation of the Einstein equation. And at the level of the frames, you use then something which gives you the null condition. So this is the sort of thing that I explained in the particular case. So we can go a little bit to this Cartan formalism. I mean, just repeat what we did last time. So you have frames, you introduce frames, right? Orthonormal frames. By the way, the frame is one, at least one element of the frame, as I explained last time, is very easy to define. You have E0. E0 is exactly the unit timeline relative to the foliation. So that's very natural. And then the other ones, E1, E2, E3, will have to be tangent to this this foliation. Okay. So that's how you keep up the frame. Of course, you still have a choice. So this is fixed. You still have a choice of picking a specific frame here. So that could be the gauge condition. Alright, so then we introduce the connection one forms, like the usual. And then the curvature can be, in fact, viewed as being the curvature of the connection. And then the Young-Mills equation, which are equivalent to the Bianchi identities for the curvature, are equal to this. And at some point, you also use the Einstein-Barkov equation. So the Einstein-Barkov equations are also included. Of course, the covariant derivative is covariant derivative relative to the metric. So obviously, the metric doesn't disappear from here, but it's hidden in the covariant derivative. Yeah. So probably still quasi-linear, of course. And then, of course, you can look at the gauge freedom. You can rotate the E gamma by using the SOS 3-1 matrices. And the change of the A from 1 E to E tilde is given by the usual formula. Okay, so now, okay, so this is a repetition of the same thing. This is the Young-Mills equation. This is a divergence of this F, which is a connection, which is a curvature, huh? And of course, if you express f now in terms of the a, you get the wave equation here. For the a, you get this type of term here also, which is still second order. And you have nonlinear terms on the right side. Of course, this term is kind of annoying because it destroys the hyperbolic character of this, but typically you know that you all recognize this as a gauge term, so you can get rid of it by using the gauge condition. So, okay, so this was a situation in curved spacetime. And then the natural thing to do is to try to think of what happens if the metric, if you divorce all these formalins from the metric. So you take the metric to be the Minkowski metric, and you study just Yapkin's equations in Minkowski space. And, okay, so this is what, this is the old result of Macedon and myself from the 90s, in which you show that the Yapkin's equations are well posed. So, well posed means exactly this notion of the fact that the time depends, the time of existence depends only on the particular solenoid. So in this case, you show that things depend on the H1 norm of the A. So A, of course, A is at the level of a derivative of the metric. So H1 in A is equivalent to H2 in G. Okay. So obviously, H1, well posed for H1, is exactly equivalent to what we want to do. But of course, I'm doing it here in a much simpler case of a flat metric. So the metric is flat. But the equations are essentially very simple. OK. So so what's important that I explained in last time is to use a Coulomb gauge. If you use a Coulomb gauge, then the equations, which were the equations we saw before. So I'm talking about these equations. And the gauge conditions that I'm going to use separates the A, so we have A separates between the T component and the AI component. Right, so it's 1, 2, 3. And okay, so so what you do, what the gauge condition that we impose, and this is essential. If you impose, for example, the more natural Lorentz type gauge condition, you don't see the null structure. If you impose this condition, then the miracle is going to occur. And under this condition, now those equations, the second order equation for the A, split into an elliptic part for A0. So this satisfies an elliptic equation. And the wave equation for A parts. Now, elliptic equations are much better behaved. So, with an elliptic equation, you can do even better than H1 somehow. So, because Laplacian, of course, gains two derivatives. So, typically, you think of a knot as being as good as you want. Okay, so, there's not going to be a problem. So, and every time when you have an A knot multiplied by an A, it's also good because A knot gains. The difficult terms are exactly the ones that don't have a problem. So they are the terms which are exactly in AI. And of course, AI verify something which looks like a wave equation, except that you still have this RD term here. And, but it's a, so it's not really a wave equation. It's not a clean wave equation. I don't know if you get it in parabolic effect, something that it's not clean parabolic, but it's still well posed. It's not a, because of this term, I mean, this interferes, of course, with the wave operator. So you have to get rid of it somehow. Anyway, what you do is that you apply the divergence, the projection on divergence free vector fields. Since the AI are divergence free, right, divergence of A is equal to 0, when I apply this operator, it commutes with the divergence, and P of AI is, of course, still AI. Because A is already divergence. So you still get this equation on the left, but you got rid of this term, which was a gradient. And on the right, you have terms which involve the projection operator applied on those vectors. The other terms, I treat them as lower somehow. Okay. Now, you see, if you didn't have this projection operator, this problem will be imposed. And there are plenty of counterexamples. So the miracle here is that somehow this projection makes these terms to satisfy the, what I call the null condition. So there is an improvement at the level of the regularity of these terms. Okay, and these are the so-called value distance. So use binary estimates to control these most dangerous terms. Right. Okay, so here is a typical binary estimate, which we had last time. I'm explaining it again. So imagine, so this is a purely linear situation, right? So you have our version of AI. We can take it to be zero. I can take this diversion distance here to be zero, so you don't have those integrals at all. So imagine that you have just the homogeneous problem. Diversion of A equal to zero, diversion of phi equal to zero. So this is just a wave equation in flat space, right? So we are talking about the standard, the simplest wave equation. And of course, we are in R3 plus 1. And this is just diversion, this is a scalar, diversion of A equal to zero. But I also need divergence of A equal to zero. In other words, VIAR is equal to zero. Of course, this, if it's satisfied initially, it's satisfied for all the data. And the estimate tells you that this combination of AI, VI, FI is better than what you would have done by string class estimates. So if you remember from last time, the discussion of the string class estimates, you see that if you try to apply string class, you lose an epsilon derivative here. But if the AI verifies the divergence condition, then in fact this behaves better. So you don't lose, you get exactly what you would like to get. Right? So in other words, you get something which is completely consistent with the H1 law. And these terms come from Eilenberg, which is an applied Eilenberg set. Alright, good. So that's okay, so this is the first theorem. There is another theorem which is under the same assumptions for the A's. The projection on divergence free vector field of this combination is also better. You see that what's important in this type of estimates is that if you have to estimate the whole thing, you cannot split it. Right? So the traditional estimates like streetcars or Sobolev and so on, they will split this into an estimate for one term and an estimate for the other. This would be, if you do that, you are dead. You don't get anything. So the important thing is to treat this like this, right? And we'll see why. Okay. And in the first approximation, we can assume this. And as I explained last time, the original estimates were proved using space-time Fourier transform. So you apply partial L. This is L2 in space-time. So you apply partial L in space-time. And you get a complicated convolution structure here, which you have to study. It's very simpler. And somehow the bilinear structure is given, you see it at the level of the kernel of the of this convolution. And there is a cancellation which allows you to get the result. Okay, so, but I want to prove a different, I want to show you another proof of the bilinear estimates, which is the one that we need in order, if we are to apply it in the curved background, in the curved space. So, you see, I guess the partial L idea using AI, VI, and estimating the space-time Fourier transform this does not work at all if you have a curved space-time. So you need a much better proof of this value estimate. And this is something that Igor and I have done about 7 or 8 years ago. Which is a very pretty proof, so I wanted to show you at least what are the main ideas of the proof. And then the proof also justifies what we have to do in curved space time. Okay, so here's what you want to do. You have the simplest possible situation. You have the division of phi equal to zero, phi is equal to f in H1, and the second derivative of phi is zero is zero. That's the simplest possible case. Okay, and I'm interested in a generalization of the bilinear estimates that we had earlier. Namely, I want to look at something which is a contraction between a tensor U and a solution of the wave equation, which has a derivative of a solution of the wave equation. I want to take L2 norm of such a contraction. So in our case, the contraction was given by AI, DI, phi. And the U is the A. Okay. But I want to do something more general, because in the bounded to curvature conjecture, we need even more complicated bilinear terms. In fact, we need terms which will involve even the curvature tensor, for example, the curvature of G. So you have to have a contraction between curvature and this sort of thing, right? And that's why this proof is much better. I mean, in fact, the whole proof will never work. Okay, so I have a tensor, so this, let's keep this tensor arbitrary for the moment, and a contraction, right? We are still in flat space for the moment. Okay, now, it turns out that the solution of that wave equation, right, good, so this is phi, it's 0, it's phi, it's f, can be expressed in terms of combination of this Fourier integral operator, so phi is in fact the sum between a term. More. So there are, you see, what we put in here in the phase, you put a solution of the Eilenberg equation. But it's a solution of the Eilenberg equation which is very simple in this case. It's just t plus x dot omega. So omega being an element of the two-dimensional sphere. So this is just the standard. So what I express here is just the standard expression of the solution of the wave equation Fourier transform. So it just expressed nicely because I want to exhibit this null equation with this sort of particular equation. Okay. So it turns out that a general solution of this is actually a superposition of this for u with a plus and the other one with u with a minus. So it suffices to forget about the general case and just look at phi of this type. In other words, I just have to look at d of phi f. So I just have to look at C, Q, and D phi in that closed space now. Okay. Next, observe, and this is very important here, that if I take the inversion of this expression, I get zero for the simple reason that U verifies the Eilenberg equation, and the inversion of U is equal to zero. This, by the way, it's not going to be true in general. So in general, if I have a metric here, if I have the same equation, right? So if I study the same equation on a background, then I have to replace this by a more complicated U, which verifies this equation with G here. Right? So it will be a solution of the Eilenberg equation for a given metric. And then this term here will not disappear. And this is a major edit, because I mean you have to prove a boundedness of this term. Anyway, we'll discuss it in a moment. Okay, so for the moment this would be zero. So this is an exact solution. In other words, this expression, this checks that this expression gives you an exact solution of the wave equation. Right, very good. Now so we look now at this expression here, so C of U and derivative of phi f. Right? And you see immediately that because of the, so let's write here, UF. So UF is just integral in this diagram down U. So this U depends on Tx and omega. And then there is a lambda squared f hat of lambda omega. So you see that when you differentiate d, sorry, this is phi. So when you differentiate d phi f, you get a derivative of u coming out, and another lambda. So that's why you get the lambda cube there, and you get the contraction now between capital U, the same kind of contraction, but now it's a contraction between capital U and the derivative of the optical function. Right? So this is u omega, is just this u omega, which in our case is t plus or minus x dot omega. Right, so it's very simple. Okay, now, so this is what it is. And now the idea, so the main observation is that J, the function J, depends only on U. In nothing else, right? So I have that this is equal to an integral of c of u d phi f, and then j of u omega. And now when I take the L2 norm, the idea is that when you take the L2 norm of space-time, right, so this is R3 plus 1, I'm going to split it into an integral along null planes. Right, so there is an integral, so for every omega, I have a foliation in null planes of the whole space-time. So that's why, see, I'm writing the integral of dx dt as an integral along a fixed null plane, integrating over the null plane, and then integrating over du. Right? So this is just the standard integration. What is it called? It's writing the Lebesgue integration in terms of integration along null planes, and then an integration in this direction. Okay, so so here is how this works. You start up with an L2 norm, and you take the L2 norm inside by a standard Minkowski inequality. So this goes inside. And now I'm at a fixed omega. You see, now omega is fixed inside. So I'm allowed to take, for that particular omega, I'm allowed to take a foliation by these null planes, a fixed omega. Okay. And so therefore what you get is exactly this in L2 of dt, but L2 of dt is now expressed in this way, and I'm using now the fact that this function j depends only on u. Okay. So because of this, I can take it in L2 here. And this part I take supremum in omega of the L2 norm on the null plane. Okay? So you see, I have the same thing for L2 norm along these null planes. And the integration in U is taken by this. Okay, but J, you see, what is J? J, look at it, J is just a Fourier transform of lambda cubed f hat squared. So it's very easy to see by partial L that this is bounded just by this. So at the end of the day, I get that this L2 norm is bounded by this times an L2 norm exactly of what I want. This is the H2 norm of F, which is exactly what I want in the binding test. Right. Okay, good. So the lemma, so this proves this lemma, that the L2 norm of that contraction is bounded in terms of the L2 norm of F in L2, so this is the H2 norm of F, and the supremum of that sort of combination. Okay. Now, the question is, how do I bound that stuff? And here comes a very important geometric insight. Maybe I should try to explain this without going into the details. Okay, yeah, it's very simple, but the implementation requires you to actually do the calculations yourself. So what is the idea? The idea is that, you see, if I take my u to be, for example, an electromagnetic field which verifies a Maxwell equation. This is so in other words, maybe like this, so d of f is 0, d of f star. Right, so these are the Maxwell equations. So imagine that u is this, or imagine that u is actually the curvature, but then I'm looking at the Bianchi identities. So this would be r delta and equal to 0. And as you know, in the case of r alpha beta is equal to 0, as we discussed before, this is also equivalent to the usual Bianchi identity. Second Bianchi identity for the curvature. Okay, so in both cases, there is an energy momentum tensor. So in this case, remember that we had an energy momentum tensor associated to F, which verifies the beta q alpha beta equal to 0. So this is a standard conservation laws, local conservation laws for the Maxwell equation. And similarly, here there is an energy momentum tensor which is has four indices, which is called the Bell-Robinson tensor. And this also verifies this is equal to zero. And in both cases, we showed how to get derived energy estimates. Right? Okay, but these energy estimates, if you remember, the estimates can be derived between two space-like hypersurfaces, so let's say 0 and D. But I can also put a null plane here, for example, or a null cone. And when I apply the energy estimate, I'm going to get an integral here is equal to an integral here plus a flux. So I'm going to estimate the flux, so this is a flux of the, right? So there is an integral over a null hypersurface of flux. Plus an integral of sigma p for the energy. And this is equal to the integral of sigma 0 of the energy of sigma 0. So this is the energy density, I should say. Density. And this is flux density. So the flux is actually the loss. So you are getting from energy estimates, you are getting estimates for the flux. But it turns out two things. First of all, the flux here, corresponding, for example, to f alpha theta, will contain only tangential derivatives along the null hypersurface. You are not allowed to have transversal derivatives. Okay. Right. So in other words, this does not allows components of f which are tangential to the null hypersurface and not the ones which are transversal. So of course this restricts what you can estimate, there, right? Because this is, you see, it's an L2-norm on a null hypersurface. Okay. But it's a contraction between u and this I omega. Well, it turns out that if the null condition is satisfied, this corresponds exactly to a flux term of the u. So I say it's a flux term corresponding to the Maxwell equation or a flux term corresponding to the curvature. In both cases, this is an allowable estimate on the null hypersurface. If the null condition is not satisfied, you are going to get the transversal component of the tensor, and this is not allowed because you don't have an estimate. The estimate only includes a flux. So this is a sort of the geometric insight in connection with Bernoulli estimates. Bernoulli estimates will only work if you have special combinations, so that the term that you get there will contain only tangential components of the null hypersurface and non-transversal ones. Yeah, sorry.
You're
going to
focus on one of the slabs, and then you have time 0 and time t.
What?
The other side is infinity.
This I don't need now. I just don't need. All I need is that this quantity is less than the initial quantity. That's all.
And you don't worry about the infinity side? It's
no, I'm doing an estimate, you see.
Between two slabs or just one slab?
So you see, the easiest thing to visualize is when you have a null hypersurface like this.
Yeah,
well,
I can see.
Right.
But,
okay, but I can also have something like this.
Yeah.
I have a null plane. Right. So I have an intersection between two space-like hypersurfaces on an R plane, and I'm looking in the exterior. I'm looking that way. So
and
I do the estimate up all the way to infinity. Right. So it's an estimate all the way to infinity between this plus this and this. So this will be the flux.
There's no infinite side boundaries
in there. There is no problem. For hyperbolic equations, there is never a problem. You can always, you know, the finite propagation speed.
Oh.
So it's never a problem. Okay. So, yeah, so this is sort of the idea. Of course, you have to actually go inside the calculation to see that indeed this combination between C and I omega. So I omega, I guess you can see what I omega is. I omega was exactly this du. So it's exactly what came out in the calculation. Okay, so let me not say more because I think if I say more, you just get confused. But roughly, this is the idea of how you prove Bernoulli estimates. And as I said, you can prove many more budget estimates, not just the ones which were needed in the Jan-Mills flood case. Okay, once you have that, then you can go to the full situation of the functional equation. And we discussed it already, but let me redo it because I went a little bit faster. So the strategy of the proof of the projective. First of all, the strategy, first part of the strategy is to get this hidden R structure of the actual equation, without which these value estimates will not work. Okay, so that's the first part. And then the idea, as I already said, is to use the Young-Mills formalism or Kaplan formalism, if you want. Express the actual equation as a Young-Mills system. And impose and then of course make a comparison to the flood case. And since in the flood case we needed a Coulomb gauge, it's natural to think that I also need a Coulomb gauge here. Okay. So what is a Coulomb gauge now? So remember, we had this picture here. Remember that I said that we can take the frame to adapt the frame to the foliation, so take this zero to be just tangent, uninormal to the foliation. Sorry, not tangent, but uninormal to the foliation. And and the other one, E1, E2, E3, to be tangent to the leaf of the foliation. And now, on the leaf of the foliation, I can impose a Coulomb gauge condition. That's the idea. So somehow, you could wonder what happens with the E0 condition, the Coulomb gauge which corresponds to the E0. Well, that's taken care just by the fact that the foliation is maximal. So the fact that the foliation is maximal is actually compatible with the Coulomb gauge condition. So that's how you do the Coulomb gauge. And then of course you have to use a projection operator, because without the projection operator we don't see the null condition. And finally, you need to prove bilinear estimates. But now to prove bilinear estimate, I don't have the wave equation in flat space, I have the wave equation on a curved vector. And of course this is much, much more. So then use the parametrics. So first of all, you have to construct the parametrics. And now the parametrics is going to be very similar to the one I wrote before, but the parametrics is not going to solve this equation exactly. There will be some error. That's why it's called the parametrics and not an exact solution. Right? So the error term is going to be a huge, huge problem. But hopefully. So that's the idea. Okay, so here is again this Young-Mills formalism. You see again these equations. And now I'm going to impose a Coulomb gauge condition. And when you do that, but you see, it turns out that the Coulomb gauge condition, you have some freedom. It doesn't have to be exactly zero. It can be of the can be quadratic in the A, which is, by the way, exactly what happens. You see, A has many components. Let me explain this. So AI is, for example, is a component zero also, right? Because this is a matrix actually, right? So you can have a component zero and let's say L. Zero component of time. And this sort of thing, divergence of this, has to do with the gradient of the second fundamental form. And that's why you get something like that, AI is equal to. You cannot make it to be exactly equal to zero, but you can make it to be quadratic in that x. Okay, fine. Once you have that condition, then the equations become very similar to the ones we've seen in the flat space. And now the big issue, the first big issue, is what happens with the projection operator. I can define a projection just like before, but of course now the projection does not necessarily commute with the wave operator anymore. And the commutators could be terrible. In fact, as I explained last night, this was one place where we were very scared, because it was not at all clear that if you apply the commutator, you are not going to generate terms that you cannot control by bilinear estimates. See, remember that everything has to work because of varying estimates. If the null structure is not present after you commute with the projection operator, you are in big trouble. So fortunately, in particular because of these more general varying estimates which I discussed, you can treat all the terms which come up from the magnitudes. So that's one big headache that we had to deal with, and fortunately it worked out. So it produces only null forms. Okay, then the next thing is to actually prove varying estimates. But now, to prove varying estimates, I have to construct solutions in curved spacetime and not in flat space. So U is a solution of the Eilenberg equation. I can choose initially to look like x dot omega, in other words, to look initially as if it was a usual Fourier transform. But obviously, so in other words, you have to start up with some initial conditions. By the way, this is also like being trivial, so. So let me say something that will make me show happy.
Hopefully. I'm happy already.
So it turns out that in order to construct these null planes, you have to pick up some initial conditions here. The most natural conditions that you would pick, which would be geometric, will be to satisfy the minimal surface equation. So this is on sigma 0, right? So I'm looking at initial condition for my Eilenberg equation. Remember that it has to depend on an omega, so it has to depend on an angle, right? So I can rotate these sort of things. Right? So I can rotate around. But the intersection with sigma 0 would be some plane on sigma 0, the most natural thing would be a minimal surface. Now, it turns out that the minimal surface is not a good choice. The minimal surface, the good choice is actually a heat flow. It's actually quite a miracle. It's a relatively simple heat flow for you, but for us. Right, so even picking up initial condition is not trivial. But once you construct this, so it looks like mean curvature. So even this is non-trivial, but once you do it, the big problem is the behavior of these non-hypersurfaces in space time. Because you have very little control. You only know that r is in the 2 of sigma t. So of course, you still have this intersection of sigma t. Okay. So here, even at the fixed omega, so there are two issues to deal with. Even at the fixed omega, it may be that this null hypersurface degenerates immediately because of questions of radius of integrity. So this is connected with what I discussed two lectures ago, when I showed that just curvature in L2, the flux of curvature, in fact, the flux of curvature along this null hypersurface gives you a control on the radius of integrity. And this is a place where there's a huge amount of work, and this is the place where actually the problem becomes really critical, because there is absolutely nothing to spare as far as the regularity. But there is an additional issue which has to do with the fact that this plane is also rotating omega. So you are all also interested in how u omega behaves when you take derivatives in omega. So this is something that we did not do. So Igor and I treated the problem of fixed omega. But this was only needed in this particular situation. Right? So you need also very good estimates for derivatives. But we need several of them. But we don't have too much, because we cannot expect too much, because each time when you try to differentiate these equations, you get derivatives of the g. And you only have two derivatives of the g. In L2, not in L2. But so obviously this is a huge problem, but it can be dealt with. And you get, as a consequence, you get lower bounds on the radius of injectivity at fixed omega. You get, of course, many other information about derivatives of this u omega. And also you get derivatives of u omega when you rotate it relative to omega. Okay,
so your initial
varies
in the C-curve flow? when it intersects with layer time, is it also an area of the flow?
It's omega. It's omega, right? For fixed omega. So the mean curvature flow is connected with the fixed omega. You fix omega and you have to define this.
Fly out.
So I'm starting, I start from infinity with something which is flat, right? And then I move it according to the mean curvature flow.
And then you solve the equation.
And then I solve the equation. So, right, so this gives me this, this long, I mean this.
And now you have intersections with
two surfaces on three spaces. Exactly.
Are those solving the flow also?
So they, no, I don't need it anymore. Right? I just need it initially.
So maybe it does, maybe it doesn't.
In fact, you have to worry about singularities in the mean curvature flow.
But so hopefully, you see, in this problem, there is one additional step that you have to do when you reduce the problem to something which is small. So the curvature is small. The curvature of the initial data is going to be small. So I have some scaling that I can do. So it's close to the impedance. It's so close to the impedance space, but I don't have. So the whole point of all this is that in some sense you stay close, you remain close to physical space. You start out close to impedance space. But of course you only control smallness of the curvature, right? Nothing else. So how the impedance is a failure. So the difficulty has to do with this high
data. So you're sweeping all the way from this infinity to the other.
Right, there's actually, there's a simple thing that we need to do. We can, if you can take initial data sets, so you can use the result of polynomial chain that tells you that if I have an initial data set, I can restrict myself to a compact set. So you see, because of domain of dependence, I'm only interested in the domain of dependence of the compact set. And outside the compact set, I can take something to be
To be simple. It's like Euclidean up to this not too big set. You just have to get across it.
Right.
The curvature is
pretty fine. Right.
Exactly. I guess you get out of the
But well, we should discuss because there is an issue here actually, because even these sort of things, like Corvino Schoen, for example, has not been proved at the level of regularity that they are interested in. They require much more regularity. So, anyway. Alright, so let's go. But again, the fundamental difficulty is not so much with the initial condition, though, even here, as I said, there are lots of non-trivial things. But the main difficulty has to do with the space-time. So the space-time, you see, construct your Fourier mirror operator. Obviously, as I said, you need a lower bound on the radius of the equivalence because these planes have to be well-defined. Right? So for example, it would be that the planes collapse in a time framework which can be made at time as small. All these parameters should be useless. Okay. So you construct that makes sense, let's say. And now, obviously, when I take the diversion of this, you see that I get the diversion of u inside. Okay, so it's the diversion of this u. Well, this happens to be exactly, it's very easy to calculate. It's exactly the trace of the now second fundamental form of the null planes. Very well known. So we've seen it many times in this lecture. So this trace color, omega. And it has to be null infinity. And fortunately, in whatever I proved to Igor Odyansky, we show that this trace is null. And this, by the way, this control of the radius of the So it turns out that the element that you have here has to be in an infinity, and it is in an infinity because that's why you didn't even have the lower bound of the radius of infinity of this null hypersurface. So this unfortunately has the right property. But of course you need a lot more. You need many other properties of u and so on. Okay, anyway, so this is
what is x?
Excuse me?
What is x?
This one?
That one, it controls the radius of the infinity.
This one, chi, yes? Chi, so
chi.
Yeah, so wait, so let me repeat. Alright, so the point is that, so this is, let's say, C+0, and we have this null plane, which is generated by null geodesics. So you define the null second fundamental form, and by the way, there are these intersections, so there is also an intersection C+0. Right. Define the non-second fundamental form to be, so let's say, car of x and y, where x and y are, x and y are tangent to the intersection between sigma t and let's call this c. So this is u omega is equal to constant, right? So this is a fixed number at the surface, so this is intersection with u omega is constant. This is just the derivative dx and y. So you take the tangential derivatives in the sigma t direction of L being the normal. L is also plays the role of the normal to the coefficients. So it's exactly the same thing, it's just that L is now both normal and tangent. Okay, so this is, and then you take the trace relative to a frame. So this turns out to be the fundamental quantity in all this stuff, and in particular, it controls the radius of projectivity. So in order to show that the radius of projectivity is controlled, we have to show that the infinity is not a problem. But again, of course, the point here is that you only control R in L2. Right? So you don't, traditionally, to control the radius of projectivity, you need R in L2. You only have that's why it makes it hard. Anyway, now you have now a Fourier integral operator here. A Fourier integral operator with a very rough phase function and a very rough amplitude, even rougher amplitude, right? Because it's just an amplitude. So the question is, can you prove, in order to close the body estimates, you need to control this error terms. In other words, I need to control the L2 norm in space time of this. Here there should be a file. Of course, if everything was smooth, if this was smooth and this was smooth, then this is standard Fourier integral operators. The theorem will be that this Fourier integral operators are bound in. Of course, what's novel here is that you have very little regularity. In fact, you have extraordinarily little regularity. And all, in fact, if you look at the literature on how you prove this healthy balance for Fourier integral operators, they require a lot of derivatives of both the amplitude and the phase. So what saves the day here is that you, in order to prove this, you have to use fully the properties of the Einstein equation. So in general, all these things that I'm talking about will be false if G was an arbitrary metric. Right. So it only works because we have G. This plays a fundamental role in everything. And here is a sort of main steps of how to define this Fourier, this parametric system. And how to bound the error terms. This is the bound of the error terms. And this takes about 4 papers, each one about 150 pages. But they are fully detailed and fully explained. So. But this is the hardest part in some sense. I mean, conceptually, the proof is quite simple, I think. I mean, what I explained to you is really the heart of the proof. But then you get to these technicalities, and that takes, unfortunately. So why 4 papers? Actually, you can see it here. In fact, 5 papers. Because the fifth we are just writing. So C1 is just what I told you. It's just how to pick up the initial condition. Right. So it's an understanding of the initial data. And of course, there is a lot of work because essentially this is pseudo differential operators in a nutshell. Because you also have to construct you make an appropriate choice for the equation satisfied by your omega. So as I said, this could be mean, some kind of mean curvature curve. And then of course you have to study the regularity of these surfaces, and then both in x and in omega. Then you have to show that the parametrics at time t equals zero. Right? So if you look at time t equals zero, you also get the parametric, and you show that this parametric generates all the initial conditions corresponding to what you want. Right? So that's another major step, which is unfortunately takes some time. Then you have to contrast the geometry of the foliation of M by these level hypersurfaces of U omega now in spacetime. So this is what this is in a sense maybe the hardest part. And that's what I try to explain. You do something at fixed omega by controlling the radiation injectivity and of course many other quantities, and then you have to also differentiate more. And you get a full set of estimates for the geometry of this now hypersurfaces. Then you have to show that the error term satisfies these estimates, which are in a sense the hardest. Because this uses everything. And it's extremely subtle. But once you have, I should say it's very, very subtle, but nevertheless, somehow you can explain the procedure. So the procedure, I mean, implementing the procedure takes a lot of time, but explaining the main steps of the procedure is actually very, very common, very conceptual. And finally, there is something else, which is still not proved, but we are proving it now, is that we need also an L4 string consistent for the pattern. This is a technical thing that I don't know. And that's about it. So what are the open questions? First of all, once you have this this result, you also want to get a global result. So that will be a much stronger version of the stability of Minkowski space because now you want to get something global. So in other words, if the initial data is small in the L2 of curvature, then you get a global solution. The most fundamental issue is this one. Can you beat the exponent that's equal to 2? And this is extremely important if you want to understand Boltzmann censorship. So the main conjecture, as I explained earlier, is general relativity. In the most celebrated would be the Boltzmann censorship conjecture. So this would be the analogous of the concurrent conjecture. But there's no million dollars. I'm sorry. We should try to convince people to make this million dollars.
Make sure somebody funds the promise.
It looks like there's money flowing into this now.
But S equal to 2 is clearly not good. You have to go all the way to the scaling exponent in order to do the cosmic separation. So it's a little bit. You have to really get very close to singularities. But we have to have an optimal epsilon regularity.
What else?
The problem is that, you see, the traditional way of doing this sort of things is using HS spaces. Right? And these are obviously not good enough because you cannot go below a single. You need something entirely different because it has to be. This is not scale invariant, so it has to be something different. You can certainly not go for s less than 2. This seems to be impossible for the reasons I have explained. So you need a totally different approach.
But something that's essentially close to 2.
No, it would have to be something at the level of the scaling exponent to
3
But it would still have to be done in terms of curvature. So and it has to be consistent to the hyperbolic character of the equation, which means you need a 2. You cannot use LPs. because it is an infinity, you know, it's a D. It has to be a 2. It has to contain curvature. So what is it? So I have a candidate, but right, we'll see. Yeah. There is, I mean, it looks like you can't do it, but there is, in fact, there is probably a way out, but it's going to be big. Anyway, so that's S equal to 2. I think that's the most major issue, because philosophically, this is the real thing. I mean, how do you get to scaling exponents? Think of it this way. I mean, think how many things depend on the null hypersurfaces. So in particular, all this stuff depends on the regularity of the null hypersurfaces. If the null hypersurface is a singularity, I have no idea. I mean, how are you going to make sense of all this and this? I think it's just pointless. I mean, that's a possibility. Could be that somebody would be able to make sense of how to deal with these non-hypersurfaces when they have singularities. But I kind of doubt. I mean, that has to be something incredible.
Yeah, I hear that there's some like religious guy who's offered $1 million prize for mathematical proof of the existence of God. So here's what you do. You argue, first you prove that cosmic censorship, and then you show that it's clear that only God must exist to prevent the formation of naked singularities.
It's a very good point, because whenever you deal with actual equations, you constantly wonder. You constantly find all sorts of, you think that it's not going to work for one reason or another, and you find this nervous. I mean, the Einstein equation is full of them.
The papers will love the story at naked singularities.
Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah. It's true. And if you can put it in a religious way, yeah, there is this, right, I know what you're talking about. What's the name? There is a prize given for a religious essay. Sorry?
Ace
got one. Okay, so I have to talk to him. But the linear is too little. Don't you think the linear is too little?
In this area of the United States,
I know. I mean, when Wall Street guys get $25 million bonuses every year, basketball players get $5, $10 million yearly contracts.
So we have to convince people.
Yeah. Well, we have to get audiences of 10,000 people
watch
this lecture.
Everyone has an organization which is promoting this kind of thing. And there are big names who are advising them, including Arthur Jeffries, you know.
Yeah, Clay, the Clay Foundation. But the Clay Foundation, it's just $1 million.
The problem is, even with only $1 million, see how the mathematicians are getting their knives sharpened. Think what a $10 million prize would do.
Yeah.
So, what is the continuation criteria?
Yeah, so this is, in other words, it could be that, chosen, I see in that sense, by not being the right way to go. The right way to go is to do this, find a better combination. In other words, all positives will not work. I mean, the standard version of all positives might not work, but something like this might still work. There's also this $3 million prize.
Yeah,
right. But they give it only for string set. It's for some reason, I don't know why.
This is a bit, it's more broad.
Yeah. Anyway, I think it's better on the prizes. Yeah,
don't say that, it might stop you.
This
Well, if there are, I don't mind. If nobody gets, you know, the socialists are not.
You can
nobody
get
gets.
National